April 20th, 1993 might be one of the most important dates in the modern country music era, because on this day 30 years ago, three future legends of the country music genre would go on to release their self-titled debut albums. One of these artists would gain massive loads of fame and infamy for stretching the boundaries of what could even be considered country music, perhaps wider than anyone before her. I'm of course talking about Shania Twain, a Canadian country singer who would cross over into the United States and become the most successful female country artist of all time. That is, if you consider her to be a country artist at all. Her debut album was released on April 20th, 1993 on Mercury Records with very little fanfare. Though it's certainly a solid album, it did not feature the production of her future husband, Mutt Lange, and thus didn't hold the crossover appeal that would eventually make her one of the most successful country artists of all time. But today's video is going to focus on the two male singers who released their debut records on this day 30 years ago. These two men would quickly rise through the ranks and become some of the biggest country stars of the 1990s and continue their legendary career paths into the new millennium. Both of these men have sold tens of millions of album units and have scored multiple number one hits and top 10 hits, creating some of the most iconic songs of the past three decades of country music. I am of course talking about Toby Keith and Tim McGraw. Yet despite releasing their debut records on the same day 30 years ago, their careers couldn't have started much differently, because one of these albums was a near instant commercial success. The other was a complete and utter failure. In today's video, we're gonna discuss the histories behind these two albums, the origins of these two singers, and to compare and contrast why one album was so successful and why the other was a failure. And of course, we'll discuss what happened next. Make sure to hit that like button and subscribe for more country music history content. Let's get to the video. Toby Keith could be considered a late bloomer by modern pop culture standards. When his debut album was released, he was just a few months shy of his 32nd birthday. And it was a very, very long road to country music stardom for this Oklahoma native. As a young man, he worked as a derrick hand in the oil fields of Oklahoma, but by the mid-1980s, his focus clearly lied with country music. During this time, he and a few of his friends formed a country music band called the Easy Money Band. And after a brief stint playing semi-pro football for the Oklahoma City Drillers, who were then an unofficial farm team of the Oklahoma Outlaws for the United States Football League, Toby Keith and the rest of the Easy Money Band soon hit the road and began playing the honky-tonk circuit throughout Oklahoma and Texas. It would take several years, but by the early 1990s, Toby Keith began busking around Nashville on his own. Harold Shedd, then an executive at Mercury Records, eventually discovered Toby Keith and signed him to a record deal. This record deal was very timely, as allegedly Toby had made a promise to himself around this time that if he didn't secure a recording contract by his 30th birthday, he would call it quits with music for good. Now, if Toby Keith was a late bloomer, then Tim McGraw definitely got a much earlier start on the road to country music stardom. Born on May 1st, 1967, a young Tim McGraw made his way to Nashville after dropping out of college in his early 20s, with making a living on the road playing country music being the only thing on his mind. His early life growing up in Louisiana had been anything but the norm. When he was 11 years old, Tim McGraw discovered that he was actually the biological son of Tug McGraw, a famous baseball pitcher. Tim met his father on a few occasions after this initial revelation, all these times being at baseball games, but Tug refused to acknowledge Tim as his biological son until his 18th birthday. And for a period, it actually seemed as though Tim would follow in his father's footsteps, securing a baseball scholarship when he was studying at Northeast Louisiana University. However, a knee injury would go on to end his playing days for good, and this is likely what prompted Tim to pick up a guitar for good. Tim McGraw signed to Curb Records just a couple years after arriving in Nashville, a label that was then the home of country music icons such as Merle Haggard and Hank Williams Jr. The first single he ever released was called What Room Was the Holiday In? It was released in 1991 and featured production from Doug Johnson. Tell me what room was the holiday in? It was a decent song to be sure, but definitely not something that would knock anyone's socks off. Ironically, it would actually be Tim's newfound relationship with his biological father that would give him a bit of a boost in the Music City. And this would give the fledgling singer's career a fighting chance in a rapidly growing sea of country music hopefuls. According to Tim's recollection in a Billboard magazine interview from 2001, it was actually the Tug McGraw connection that got him in the door with Mike Curb, president of Curb Records, in the first place. There's even one story from former radio director director John Hart, who at that time was a programmer for WXTU in Philadelphia. Hart recalls scheduling McGraw, who at this time only had this one single to his name, on his show for only one specific reason. He was Tug McGraw's son, and for the record, he thought the song was terrible. Very quick aside here about that first single, What Room Was the Holiday In? According to Discogs, there are two versions of this 45 RPM 7-inch single. One version is double-sided, so it has the same song on both sides, and the label for this version just says Holiday In, not the full title, What Room Was the Holiday In? Then the second version of this 45 RPM single features the full title, What Room Was the Holiday In, but with a different song on its B-side. This song is called Dressed to Kill. It was also produced by Doug Johnson, probably recorded during the same session. This song seemingly doesn't exist online. I can't find this song anywhere. Unlike its A-side, it did not eventually appear on Tim McGraw's debut album as his first ever single, and I have yet to find the audio on YouTube or anywhere else. So what we have here might be a genuine piece of lost Tim McGraw media. And this would be a crazy find, because as the B-side to his first ever single, this would be, you know, the second song ever released to the public by Tim McGraw, who of course is, you know, one of the biggest country stars of the past 30 years. Like, the fact that no one has seemed to find this song yet is actually kind of strange, considering Tim's high profile. So to anybody watching who might have had connections to a radio station back in the day or owned a bar with a jukebox, and you might have received a promotional version of this single all the way back in 1991, I am putting out the call right now, asking y'all to go dig through that stack of 45s that y'all haven't even touched in 30 years, because we gotta find this song. Back to the main plot, Tim McGraw seemed to finally be finding his footing in Nashville when he started working with a star-studded production team. These were some heavy hitters that would be helping out Tim McGraw record his first ever album. The list of names included James Stroud, Byron Gallimore, and Lynn Petersell. Stroud in particular was a huge name to have in his corner, as he was then president of Giant Records and had already produced blockbuster records for the likes of Clint Black, Tracy Lawrence, John Anderson, and more. Petersell was a sound engineering wizard and had his fingerprints all over the sound of mainstream country music from the mid-1980s up until his sudden death in 1995. But the last of these three men, Byron Gallimore, would end up becoming the most fruitful relationship for Tim McGraw to develop during this period. As Gallimore remains on Tim McGraw's studio team to this very day and has been involved in some capacity in every single McGraw release ever. The first commercial effort to emerge under the production of this new team would be the 1992 single Welcome to the Club. Welcome to the club. Don't be thinking you're the only one. A clear step up from his first single, Welcome to the Club is a solemn, mid-paced country rocker with strong electric guitar melodies and steel guitar presence. The lyrics reflect a familiar country music trope of drinking your sorrows away with your fellow losers in love in the bar, but the premise reflected in the song's title makes it a little bit more memorable than the average tear in your beer country song. Rather than merely singing about his most recent heartbreak, the speaker is initiating the listener into the ranks of the heartbroken in the bar, hence the refrain of Welcome to the Club. And it briefly seemed as though this song would finally be Tim McGraw's admittance into the club of country music stardom. This was the first McGraw tune to ever receive its own music video, and it remained on the country singles charts for a few months, eventually peaking at number 47. Not a hit by any stretch of the word, but certainly not a horrible performance after retooling with a brand new production team and prepping for an upcoming album's release. But unfortunately, stardom was not waiting right around the corner for McGraw. His next single, ultimately the third to be released from his upcoming debut album, was even stronger than Welcome to the Club. People ask me what you do, and son, you're gonna drive yourself insane. Memory Lane was co-written by Lonnie Wilson and Joe Diffie, who by that point was already a megastar within the country music world. With yet another big name in his corner, surely things would finally begin to turn for McGraw. But this simply wasn't the case. Memory Lane is probably my favorite song from Tim McGraw's debut album, and I think it's easily the most memorable. It's a punchy, hard-hitting country dance song with an irresistible groove and that sleek, mid-90s country production style that I personally can't get enough of. Despite the strength of the tune, though, the song peaked at just number 60 on the country singles chart. Another quick aside here, the promo CD version of Memory Lane, the CD single that, you know, was released promotionally to radio programmers and album reviewers and all that, states that it's from the upcoming Curb Records release, Welcome to the Club, which seems to indicate that Welcome to the Club was the original working title for Tim McGraw's debut album. Now, Memory Lane debuted on the country charts on April 10th, 1993, just 10 days before the release of his self-titled album. So there is a strong possibility that Tim McGraw's debut album was originally supposed to have a different title, and the choice to make it a self-titled release was a last-minute decision. But while Tim McGraw was still grinding it out after a couple years in Nashville, things worked much faster for Toby Keith. On February 12, 1993, Toby Keith had released his first single to country radio, a self-penned ode to the Wild Wild West. I should have been a cowboy. The song was an almost instant hit. By the summer of 1993, it was the number one song on country radio. Not only would Keith's debut single reach the very top of the country music charts, but it would cross over into the mainstream Hot 100 and would eventually be recognized as the most played song on country music radio for the entire 1990s decade. Not bad for your first try, and the hits just kept coming. The second single off the album, He Ain't Worth Missing, hit number 5. Girl, you gotta listen, don't you know he ain't worth missing. And the third and fourth singles, A Little Less Talk and A Lot More Action and Wish I Didn't Know Now, both hit number 2. I wish I didn't know now what I didn't know. Toby Keith's debut album is definitely an interesting release. It features very polished, almost cavernous production, certainly placing it squarely within the early 90s in terms of production values. And those who are more familiar with Toby Keith's later work might actually be kind of shocked by how polished and smooth the sound is compared to the more bold and in-your-face material of his later years. There is some rowdier material, such as the aforementioned A Little Less Talk and A Lot More Action, which was one of only two songs that Toby Keith didn't either write or co-write. Satisfaction with a little less talk and a lot more action. But many of the other songs on the album, including the hit singles He Ain't Worth Missing and Wish I Didn't Know Now, are downright sentimental, melancholy, lamenting lost love. It's a very different side of Toby Keith than you might be used to if you're more familiar with his later work. There's far less rowdy lyricism and in-your-face rock-influenced guitars, and much more spacey, open production, more acoustic guitars, more keyboards even. With this album, not only did Keith quickly establish himself as one of the brightest new singers in country music, but one of the best new songwriters as well. As I mentioned, he penned 8 of the 10 songs on this track list. He was a true triple threat. He had strong vocals, he was an instrumentalist, and he had pretty solid pen game as well. And with this first album, he immediately carves out his own niche within the country music genre. There's plenty of twang and some odes to the neo-traditional school on this album, but for the most part, Toby does walk the line between contemporary pop country sounds of the time and the neo-traditional movement. And so what this album creates is a very intriguing fusion of the twang of neo-traditional country and more contemporary pop, maybe even adult contemporary sensibilities that would go on to become more popular in the latter half of the 1990s in country music. It's certainly a solid album, but my biggest issue with Toby Keith's self-titled debut, actually, is that it's a little too top-heavy. The singles are definitely the best songs off this album, with Under the Fall being the only, in my opinion, super memorable album cut from the tracklist. I find the rest of the tracklist to actually be pretty weak. You're still under the fall. But regardless of my opinion about the inconsistencies of this debut album, it was clear that Toby Keith was here to stay. He had fully arrived. And shortly after its release, Toby Keith, the self-titled debut album, would be certified platinum for sales of over 1 million copies, easily making him one of the top newcomers of 1993. By the time Memory Lane reached its mediocre peak on the country singles charts, Tim McGraw's debut album was impacting the streets. And there actually is a lot to like about this first album from Tim McGraw. Aside from the aforementioned 3 singles, all of which were released before the album, there are a few more hidden gems within this tracklist. The ballad Tears in the Rain is actually the second Joe Diffie co-write on the album. And The Only Thing I Have Left sees Tim McGraw performing one of his favorite George Strait deep cuts from a decade prior. And the only thing in the whole wide world is you. What She Left Behind features a fantastic twin fiddle hook, and You Can Take It With You When You Go is another upbeat, guitar-driven country dance tune with some awesome guitar leads. The fourth and final single to be released from Tim McGraw's debut album was the fast-paced Two Step in Mind, which performed even worse than Memory Lane, peaking at a paltry number 71 on the country singles charts. I've got a two-step in mind and a honky-tonk horn. By this time, the writing was on the wall. Tim McGraw's debut album was a flop. To date, this album has not received any sort of sales certification from the RIAA. In the same 2001 Billboard magazine article that I referenced earlier in the video, sales estimates for this album at that time were just over 300,000. Who knows what that figure is at now? None of the songs off this record appear on any of the multitude of Tim McGraw Greatest Hits compilations released over the years. And I might be wrong, but it probably wouldn't be a stretch to assume that not a single one of these songs has been performed live by McGraw since the original promotional dates for this album. Even with the benefit of hindsight, it is sort of a mystery as to why this album failed so miserably. There are some great songs on this project. Welcome to the Club and Memory Lane rank right up there among my favorite Tim McGraw hits from this era of his career. But one could make the argument that while this album is decent and has some solid songs, Tim McGraw ultimately doesn't do enough to plant his flag as the next big male voice in country music. There's no unmistakable career-defining hit anywhere on the track list, and McGraw's relatively reserved vocal delivery doesn't really do him any favors either. In short, this album simply didn't do enough to help McGraw stand out from the rapidly growing field of Nashville hat acts. But clearly, Curb Records and the production team saw some potential in the young Louisiana native because they rushed back to the studio. Less than a year after the release of Tim McGraw's self-titled debut record, in fact, just 39 weeks and 4 days later, a simple little song you might have heard of titled Indian Outlaw was released to country music radio on January 22nd, 1994. And seemingly overnight, everything changed. Indian Outlaw is simply put one of the most controversial country hits of the 1990s. With its politically incorrect lyrics invoking numerous stereotypes and cliches of American Indian culture, even the music press of 1994 seemed shocked and awed that this song was released at all. Certain radio stations refused to play the song, and reviews of it were typically mixed. Writers couldn't deny the catchiness and potential hit power, yet were seemingly appalled by the lyrical content. Regardless of this controversy, one thing that is undeniable about this song is the sudden change in McGraw's image and demeanor. While many of the tracks on his debut album were relatively understated, Indian Outlaw is as in-your-face as country music got in the 1990s. It's provocative, offensive, and utterly ridiculous, but it is undeniably one of the best country dance tunes from an era where country dance classics were coming out on a weekly basis. The iconic music video also demonstrates this sudden change in McGraw's image. Rather than a diminutive, coy, shy, yet hungry hat act, McGraw comes across as undeniably suave and cool as he swings on stage with his Fender Telecaster that he never actually strums and tearing out onto the road on his motorcycle with his lady friend in tow. Finally, he was standing out from the crowd, and the rewards were near instantaneous. Despite its controversial lyrical content and a small-scale boycott on radio, Indian Outlaw was McGraw's first legit hit. It peaked at number 8 on the US country singles charts, but shockingly crossed over into the all-genre Billboard Hot 100, hitting a peak of number 15, back in an era where it was still very rare for country singers to cross over into the mainstream top 40. And the rest is history. Not a moment too soon, Tim McGraw's sophomore record was released on March 22, 1994, and would go on to become one of the best-selling albums, not just in country music, but in all of music, for the calendar years of 1994 and 1995, eventually being certified by the RIAA for sales of over 5 million copies. And when you compare these two albums side by side, it's really not that hard to see why Not a Moment Too Soon so easily outperformed Tim McGraw's debut. It's simply a superior album by just about every single metric. The production is sleeker, the songwriting is stronger, and even McGraw's vocal performance takes a notable step up. This album spun off numerous iconic hit singles, yet even the album cuts, such as the rowdy opener It Don't Get Any Countryer Than This, the love ballad I Wouldn't Want It Any Other Way, which features some gorgeous steel guitar, and the fantastic album closer Ain't That Just Like a Dream, all could have turned into massive hits in their own right. My opinion is that from top to bottom, Not a Moment Too Soon is one of the best written, best produced pop country albums of all time. And when I say pop country, I of course mean pop country by 1994 standards. Obviously, compared to what's coming out of Nashville now, this stuff sounds like Merle Haggard. With not a moment too soon, Tim McGraw and his team had pulled off the extremely rare and extremely impressive reverse sophomore slump, utterly burying his debut album in terms of commercial success and recognition. What I would like to know is what your opinion is on Tim McGraw's debut album. Why did it fail? Was it just a bad album? Was it a very underrated and overlooked album? Do you think any of the songs could have or should have become hits? This is an era of Tim McGraw's career that is really never discussed, probably because it's a very humbling and perhaps even embarrassing start to what turned into a legendary career. Tim McGraw would go on to have one of the most successful runs of country music stardom for the latter half of the 1990s all the way until the mid-2010s. Not only reaching the top of the country charts on numerous occasions, but regularly crossing over into the mainstream top 40, becoming one of the best crossover country singers of all time. But interestingly, despite getting off to a much slower start, one could make the argument that by the end of the 1990s and the turn of the new millennium, Tim McGraw was a much bigger star than Toby Keith was. Because at that time, circa 1999 or so, Toby Keith's future in country music looked more uncertain than ever. Despite getting off to such a hot start with his platinum-selling debut album that produced one of the biggest country music singles of all time, Toby Keith, for whatever reason, was clearly not prioritized by his label. And in fact, his first four albums as a country music artist were released under three different record label names: Mercury Records, Polydor Records, and A&M Records, all of which were under the Mercury Records umbrella. Keith, of course, had his fair share of big hit singles and hit albums throughout the rest of the 1990s, continuing to expand on his own unique brand of contemporary pop country. But by the end of the 1990s, and as the new millennium loomed large, it became clear to Keith that he needed a change. Mercury Records seemingly did not prioritize him anymore, and they turned down several of his pitch songs at this time. Keith even had a very unsuccessful run at country radio at this time, releasing numerous singles that didn't even make the top 40. By 1999, Keith's relationship with Mercury had soured completely, and after they rejected two songs from his upcoming fifth album, he left the label entirely. But just as his career seemed to be reaching its lowest point, a familiar face entered the picture. As James Stroud, who was now president of DreamWorks Records' Nashville division, scooped up Toby Keith the instant he became a free agent. Keith's first single released for DreamWorks was yet another stall at a country radio, but eventually they handed him the keys and let him release the single he wanted to release. And that song would go on to become not only one of the biggest hits of his career, but the song that opened the second phase of his career. How do you like me now? The song was to be the title track of Toby Keith's upcoming fifth studio album, How Do You Like Me Now? And the song took off like a rocket, became a massive crossover hit, and potentially saved Toby Keith's career in the process. In my opinion, this album marks the beginning of the iconic Toby Keith persona that we all recognize today. Bold, brash, unapologetic, boisterous, but loads of fun. He also began to diversify his sound during this era, experimenting with elements of rock and even rap on some of his singles. Keith spent the first half of the aughts releasing albums under the DreamWorks Records imprint, and this would undoubtedly be the most lucrative period of his career. It's very interesting to look back at the Toby Keith output from, say, 2000 to 2012, and his output from 1993 to 1999. It's unmistakably the same voice, yet it kind of seems like you're listening to two different singers. The music Keith put out in the 90s was actually quite similar to McGraw's output at the time. Slickly produced contemporary country that straddled the line between traditional country sounds and mass commercial appeal. Regardless of whichever era of Toby Keith's career is your personal favorite, there is no doubt that he got off to an incredible start, and he is one of the very few entertainers in any form of media, especially in the modern era, who you could say peaked after their 40th birthday. Who's to say that country music has to be a young man's game? And thus ends the story of April 20th, 1993. At least the Tim McGraw and Toby Keith version of the story. If y'all want me to talk more about Shania Twain's debut, we could certainly talk about that as well. But I think this is a very interesting and very underrated story because, as I've said, Toby Keith and Tim McGraw were both country music superstars At the same time, both debuted on literally the same day, and both arguably reached their commercial peaks around the same time, especially around the turn of the millennium. Yet their careers got off to completely different starts, and it really is interesting to think that one of them started out literally at the top of the country music charts, while the other couldn't even sniff a hit for his first few years in the industry. It's just such an interesting contrast. And the funny thing is, like I said, one could have made the argument that by the turn of the millennium, Tim McGraw was absolutely the more popular and more successful country singer, despite getting a later start or perhaps a delayed shot at stardom compared to Toby Keith. Like, once McGraw was on, like, he was on and he never looked back. Whereas Toby Keith, although releasing, you know, a multitude of hits and having multiple platinum selling albums in the 90s, definitely took a while to truly find his footing and his identity within the country music sphere. He was a very reliable hitmaker in the 90s, absolutely had his own brand of contemporary country and was a very respected songwriter, but he definitely wasn't like an A-tier singer in the 90s. He didn't really hit that country music A tier until How Do You Like Me Now, and you know, that really changed everything for him, and like I said, launched phase two of his career right around his 40th birthday. And so I think this is a very interesting story. I am going to be very excited to read y'all's comments. Hit that like button, subscribe for more country music history videos, and I'll see you guys next time.